Have you ever wondered what it's like to live in a city full of superheroes? To literally see people fly across the sky? Crap.
What are you up to, Angus?
Oh, hey, Sal. I'm trying to record an ad for the podcast.
Heroes don't do paperwork?
Yeah, that one.
Need any help?
Yeah, actually. I'm just trying to tell people about the show, about how you and I work at a newspaper in Super City, and how we interview various citizens, from the people we call neighbors to the city's greatest heroes. But I'm having trouble wording it.
You could just use that section you recorded and put that in.
Huh. Yeah, I suppose I could. Thanks, Sal.
Don't worry about it. I'm off to the office supply store. It got hit with a shrink ray, so everything is 50% off. Want to come?
You know what? I kind of do. Oh, for those of you hearing this, if you want to hear more about the thrilling adventures and heroics of Super City, come check out Heroes Don't Do Paperwork on the Podcavern Network. All right, let's go.
Hi, everybody. I'm Brad.
I'm Laura.
I'm Sam.
And I'm Tong.
And we are the Pixar Pals, or you might know us as...
Disney Dummies!
That's right. Welcome back to another episode of Pixar Pals, the show where we watch all the Pixar movies in chronological order and chat about them. We've been making our way through them. We're doing pretty well. I think this is number 11.
Something like that.
That sounds right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And we're getting,
close to halfway.
We should find out.
Yeah. So today we are revisiting some old friends and maybe making some new ones or enemies. We will see. Today we are talking Toy Story 3.
Nailed it.
No problem. Does anybody want to start us off with some memories of the movie? Tung, how did you first see this movie?
Yes, 2010, right? Toy Story 3?
2010.
I interject?
Yeah.
Before you start.
Yeah.
Event movie, right?
I mean, I was going to say it.
You weren't going to say it?
I was going to say it right away.
An event movie that's full of scenes that are entire events.
Listen,
okay.
I wasn't going to say it off the top because I don't want to.
We do.
I was trying to be cool for once. I was trying to be cool for once because I'm usually the person who just fucking just goes in and is like, event movie. Very aggressively. And I'm going to go ahead and say, Sam, yeah. I mean, like, you know, we've had our event movies, which are event movies. And then we have event movies, which are event movies, if you fucking know what I mean.
I think for Sam and I, there's only the second category.
Yeah, it's true. Being a little more cutthroat than you are, but...
There's event movies,
listen,
and there's not.
I love Pixar. That's why we're doing Pixar Pals, okay?
Yeah.
But, like, yeah, let's go back. Let's flash back into 2010. I was 20 years old. And this movie... Okay, so I think we've talked about other movies in 2010. What was the 2010 movie of, like, Disney? Someone can remind me afterwards. Was that Tangled?
Tangled, maybe?
Or Tangled-ish?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
That sounds about right. So, like, yeah, I love Tangled, but I didn't love Tangled until I met Laura, right? Because, like, it became...
He loves me.
Yeah, I do. I don't know why I said, yeah. But...
I didn't question it.
It only became much more important of a movie once I met Laura and stuff like that. But Toy Story, as we've known from Toy Story 1, Toy Story 2, I fucking adore Toy Story. It's like one of my favorite franchises. It brings me childhood wonder and joy and all this other stuff that, like, it just, like, because I used to play with toys. I, like, had a vivid imagination with all my toys, and I have a very strong bond with them because of these movies. And then Toy Story 3 came out, and it was like end of the trilogy, end of an era. And I know we're not talking about Toy Story 4 because we'll get to that eventually, but this seemed like a monumental event. This is the end of a chapter for this trilogy of all these characters that I love. So I remember this quite well. Like, in theaters, I went with some people in a time when I wasn't going to too many animated movies, like Tangled. I think I brought up Superstore and how I watched that, like, you know, during work and stuff like that. But Toy Story 3, like, I went opening opening, and I went like another few times after that, and I just bawled my eyes out, and just like the feelings that I have for this movie and had like very strong nostalgia, and I own it on Blu-ray. And I don't even own Toy Story 2 on Blu-ray. I own Toy Story 1 on VHS. I don't own Toy Story 2, but I own the shit out of Toy Story 3. And yeah, I loved it. And I watched it a bunch of times afterwards. But honestly, it's been a handful of years. So I was really looking forward to watching it this time around. Yeah, so that's my nostalgia.
Nice.
I feel like I remember them kind of putting it out there as like the culmination of the trilogy. So yeah, definitely quite the event when it was announced. But yeah, what about you, Laura? What's your nostalgia factor here?
I don't know. I don't remember where I watched it or when I watched it or who I watched it with, but that incinerator scene really just implanted itself in my memory. So that made an impression. And then they'll hit you again at the end. And those were my big takeaways, were those two scenes.
They hit you a few times.
I think I've only seen it once since I saw it in theaters and then saw it again yesterday.
Wow.
I married this woman.
I am but one.
You are. You're one now.
I am a multitude, actually. I contain multitudes.
Yeah.
I wish I remember. I don't know. Like, I probably would have seen it in theaters. I was in my fourth year of university in a 5-year program. So I was like in school. Oh, anyways, the one thing I looked up, so it came out in 2010. It came out on June 18th, 2010. And who would have known that 12 years later on that day?
Oh, really?
We got married.
We got married on Toy Story 3. Wow.
On Toy Story 3 release day.
Yeah,
so,
wow. What about Toy Story 4? We're not on that.
Okay. You know what else came out? You know what else came out on June 18th, though? The Chris Evans BuzzFeed puppy interview. 12 years later.
But he was
This is all very significant.
Yeah, there was June a lot of a big event day. Level things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But he was promoting Lightyear, and that's a whole other conversation.
We'll leave it.
We'll get there.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's pretty good still. I mean, yeah, there's definitely a lot of, which we'll obviously get into, but a lot of iconic moments, I feel like, in this movie that bring a lot of feelings and action.
Feelings?
And, yeah.
No.
Feelings just...
Never heard of him.
Us?
What about you, Sam? What's your recollection of this movie?
Yeah, it's funny that you bring up the release date, because as soon as you said it, I was like, oh yeah, I remember it was in June. Like, I remember counting down like the months and the like I remember when it was announced and like leading up to. I remember this being like, this is why it's an event to me, where it was like, it wasn't just like, oh yeah, this Pixar movie's coming out. It was like, no, like I am hyper aware of this movie. Like, I know it is like this many days away. Like, I was super looking forward to this movie. And yeah, I mean, I was around the same, at the same life point as you, like in university and stuff. And I remember me and all my roommates went, and I vividly remember, because the scene where Mr. Potato Head is on a pita, they all turned to me and they were like, this is what you're like when you're drunk. I was like, oh no. So that stuck with me.
He's surprisingly limmy for a two-dimensional object.
It's pretty crazy. So I feel like we were like, it hit so hard too, because we kind of grew up with Andy at those stages in our life. Like, he's going off to college and we would have just been like kind of wrapping college there. So I feel like the timing of that was like just like hits like home a little. So yeah, like the nostalgia, I definitely saw it. I remember seeing it. I definitely own this one on Blu-ray as well, and I must have watched it a handful of times, because yeah, if you would have asked me to do the summary, I feel like I could have done it's been a few years now, but as we were watching it I was like this is Toy Story to me. Like, I don't, when I picture Toy Story movies, like so many of the moments, like I've definitely watched this one more than I've watched any of the other ones, like far.
Yeah, me
so
too.
I like, it just came back so much. So yeah, strong nostalgia.
Nice. You are all gonna love my hot takes later.
Oh no, juicy.
I swear to God.
Well, yeah, I feel like that's some good nostalgia though. Some late college stuff. And I do think we're all around that similar age where this, I also remember it hitting home, sure. At least for me, I was getting towards the end of my college career. And yeah, it just kind of like takes you back to being like, oh yeah, before I had to pay bills and worry about where I'm going to live next year and all that kind of stuff.
Ugh, way to bring down the room, Brad.
Right? But So for once, normally I, for my nostalgia, I'm like, yeah, I guess I saw it in theaters, probably watched it with my brother, probably blah, blah. This one, I actually do have nostalgia for, because this was between my third and fourth year at Sheridan doing animation, and we have to do an internship. So for my internship, because I have a dual citizenship with South Africa and Canada, so I ended up going to
Flex.
South Africa for my internship and working at an animation studio there. And I've got a lot of family there. So my birthday happens to be June 19th, which was right after the movie came out. And I took my little cousin to see it at a theater in South Africa. And I remember being like really worried that it was way too dark and scary for him while we were watching it. But also just being like blown away, obviously, at how gorgeous the movie is and the story for it all. And I do remember being like really excited to go and see it because, yeah, it was like the culmination. Obviously, like in another country, I was my first little job doing like animation professionally. I feel like everybody at the studio was going to see it. It was kind of like, it was electric when it came out, from what I remember. So, yeah, this was probably one of the more fond memories I have that has stuck with me.
That's nice.
So, yeah. But Laura, I would like you to take us through the movie so we can all relive it yet
Moi?
again together. Yeah,
Moi?
please.
A summary? Bien sûr. I've had a few sips of a drink and suddenly I'm français. Okay, everyone. Well, to open things up, Toy Story 3. The toys are moving up in the world. We are in a very highly produced situation where Mr. Potato Head, aka One-Eyed Bart, I believe is his villain name, is on a high-speed train attempting to escape Sheriff Woody with, supplementary characters also involved in this subplot. Mrs. Potato Head is there. We've got Jesse and Bullseye helping. There's a Barbie convertible with the little alien guys. Do those alien guys from Pizza Planet have a name?
This is Pizza Planet Aliens.
Are they just the aliens?
Yeah, I
think so.
I want to
Toy
call them. I
aliens.
want to call them minions,
No, they're aliens.
but I
They're
know they're not minions. I feel
Yeah,
like
they're
minions are based
aliens.
on them. Yeah,
The Toy Story aliens.
yeah. So the Toy Story aliens are
Pizza
there.
Planet aliens. They're from Pizza Planet.
Yeah. So basically, Woody and Jesse and Bullseye are trying to enact this dramatic rescue mission to save the orphan trolls on the train, but they're unsuccessful, and the train goes over the broken bridge. But then Buzz Lightyear saves the day. But then evil Dr. Porkchop appears in the sky and he releases death by monkeys. And just before everyone is killed, we realize that we are inside the imagination of Andy. And we kind of zoom out and we're watching a video of childhood Andy playing with his toys.
This intro fucks.
Yeah.
This
Yo,
it was really good.
It
fucks.
does.
You know
It
why it fucks?
does.
I mean, like, it's obvious to the people in this room, but I'll just say it for the people in the audience. Like, this is Toy Story 1, but they produced it in Toy Story 3 and they show it.
Okay,
Like,
wait, explain that, because
because they.
watching this, I was like, to me, this is the Toy Story opening. I'm like, this,
It
oh,
is.
because he's,
This is what they do in Toy Story 1, but he doesn't have Jesse and
oh.
stuff yet. But like,
And
so
he doesn't have the like, it's in the room as
they're
it's
showing it
happening,
in the
right?
room,
Yeah,
like,
but
exactly.
like in
So
Toy
here we're
Story
inside.
1, you have the exact same. It's the exact same plot, pretty much, where it's just like you have One-Eyed Bart, you have evil
He's
Dr.
robbing a
Porkchop,
bank.
you have the dinosaur who eats force fields. Like all of that, all of it's referential to what Andy
Okay.
says in the first movie when he's playing with his toys, minus Jesse. Like Jesse comes in later, right? So they obviously added that in later, but to call back immediately to Toy Story 1 by making it this huge production and making it look absolutely fucking gorgeous. Because obviously we've advanced many, many years now into technology. Like it is such a cool flex and also a great, what's the word? Homage to Toy Story 1. And it
It's like setting a scene without being, because like, yeah, you say this and I'm like, oh yeah, but because they've obviously done it in a different way, you don't notice, like, you might not notice it necessarily. So it still feels like a different opening to a movie. And I don't know, it's just so clever
Oh yeah, I
to
noticed
do.
right away just the way that they're like money, 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 money. It's all that is just like, oh, they
It's
literally
Andy
say that
talking
in
through
Toy
the
Story
toys.
1. Yeah, it's really
Oh, that's
cool.
so, yeah. Yeah. Watching this, I'm like, yes, this is how any Toy Story starts. Like, this is the opening.
And we get to
Perfect.
see inside Andy's imagination this time, which is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And so this scene leads into a kind of video montage of Andy growing up. And it is, of course, set to You've Got a Friend in Me. because they know what the people want, and they wanted that song.
I do really like this opening as well, like the old school movies and stuff. And then like at the end of it all, it fades out, but it's like, and it's just like, friendship will never die.
Like goes out. When we were watching, I was like anticipating that part, and I was like, am I misremembering this? Because this movie, like you said, it is kind of dark in a lot of spots, and we'll get there. But this moment, like watching him do the stuff, I was like, oh, wouldn't it be cool if it ended this way? And then I was like, wait, I think it does end that way. And it does, it totally does. And I'm like, oh, it's so like creepy.
It's very confident in itself and its intro. Like it just puts its best foot forward right away, which is and it keeps going.
And then it puts the toys forward into their toy box where they are all very excited. We see a portable phone in the toy box, and they're all amping up to make a phone call. So the phone call is made, and then a cell phone that's also in the toy box starts ringing, and Andy opens the box, which is clearly what they were going for here. So Andy reaches in, he digs around, he picks up his cell phone. Rex is holding on to it. He throws Rex back in and he closes
the lid. Are you sure that was Andy? He was a lot older than last time we saw him.
He was a grown up Andy, 17 years old.
Got a deep voice now.
Yeah. So you could tell that the toys were super hyped for this plan and they're starting to lose hope. So they really thought that this was their last chance to be played with. And we sort of come to realize that most of Andy's toys are now gone. And it's really kind of that core gang that's left. Andy is 17. He's going to college. And the toys are preparing for life in the attic.
Oh, it's so sad.
Yeah.
When Woody's like, I know we've lost some people or some friends along the way or whatever. Yeah. It's just like the seven of them or whatever.
And we're about to lose a few more because the remaining army guys decide that they're taking off. They're not going to wait to see if they end up in the attic or the garbage or what. They parachute out the window and kind of say peace, good luck. So we've got,
I love that so much. Because they definitely are say? Garbage.
Oh,
they're like, we're always the first to go out.
Yeah,
like,
we're always
this is so
we're
like real.
I forget what the last guy says when he jumps out, but both Sam and I cracked up because they're all just like, it's been an honor.
Yeah, it's like jumps. They say good luck, and he's like, "You're gonna need it." And then he
pulls the pressing.
Wow,
so depressing.
So good.
So these toys are mentally preparing for what's next, and they basically figure they're either going in the attic or they're going in the trash. And Andy's mom comes in to remind him that he needs to make decisions before he leaves for college on Friday. And after putting it off, he kind of reluctantly picks up a trash bag and starts to throw them all into this black garbage bag. I mean, a black garbage bag is never going to be, you're always a little bit worried where that thing's going. Except Woody. Woody gets to go in a box that is labeled college. So Woody is going to go on a college adventure. So we see Andy open the attic latch and he pulls down the ladder. He's about to bring the bag up, but then he gets distracted by his little sister Molly and he just kind of leaves the bag there. Andy's mom stumbles over it, finds this bag of toys, and since they're in a garbage bag, she assumes that they're supposed to go in the garbage because the attic stairs have now closed. Oh no. So she brings them down to the side of the road and guess what? It's garbage day and the truck is three houses away. So Woody,
Brad. 10 minutes later, it's garbage day.
Yeah. Telling Laura, I'm just like, wait, you're starting to throw it like, do it the night before. Come on, Andy's mom.
He's a teenager. He's not going to do it the night before. So Woody sees this happening. And so he's like, I got to save them. He grabs a pair of scissors. He jumps down, slides down the drain pipe. At the same time, the toys are inside the trash bag trying to poke themselves out with Rex's tail. And Andy just kind of watches all of the garbage get loaded onto the truck. And then the big crushing thing comes down. He's like, fuck, my friends are dead. But then he notices this recycling box moving. And of course, they made it out safely. But now they got a chip on their shoulder because as much as Woody insists that they were about to go in the attic, they are convinced that Andy had intended to throw them in the trash. So they are bitter.
Andy did say at one point that these toys were junk.
Like, he did call them junk.
He called them junk. Yep. He's like, nobody wants these toys. We don't need to donate them. They're junk. So they heard that as well.
He said they were junk, but then he planned to keep them because
Yeah.
He puts up a tough front, but we know Andy's
only said that so his mom wouldn't try to give them away.
Exactly.
Yeah. He's a teenager.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, yeah, they're pissed. So they are like, you know what? You know what the best option here is? We get donated. So they climb in the sunny side box that is bound for the local daycare center. And while Woody is trying to convince him, no, seriously, he was trying to save you. He was trying to put you in the attic. And Buzz is like, let's hear Woody out and all this stuff. The car pulls away. Andy's mom hops in. Car pulls away with the toy box in the back seat.
Can we just say that Barbie is also in this box too?
Oh, yes. I'm so sorry.
Thing. I was like, we skipped over Barbie's introduction and...
Was Barbie in the second movie?
Yes, Barbie. First of all, yes. I was waiting for Ken to show up, but yes, Barbie. Barbie Fox. This Barbie especially Fox. Barbie was in the second movie, but it's a different Barbie.
Yeah.
It was like the pilot.
It was like flight attendant Barbie.
Completely
in,
different.
In the toy store.
Yes, Barbie. But
this is Molly's Barbie that she decided to donate.
This Barbie's
and
awesome.
This Barbie Fox.
Yeah.
And she is distraught because she actually was like, Molly looked her in the eye and threw in the donation box. So that's got to be tough for a toy.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, that was cool. So they arrive. Woody's trying to say, like, daycare is going to be the worst. It's going to be sad, boring. Like, we need to get home to Andy. And the toys aren't having it. So they arrive at Sunnyside. Andy's mom brings them up to the counter, and she's kind of chatting with a staff member there. And this is where we meet a new character, a new human character named Bonnie. And Bonnie is a young girl, maybe 4 years old, 5 years
Very
old.
Very young.
But she's kind of playing with this monkey on the counter, and she's kind of interested in the toys. And so she's just sort of introduced there. So the box of toys is brought into a nursery, and through the holes in the box, they spy maybe a dozen or so children gently playing with all these well-loved toys. And it's a very peaceful, kind of loving, idyllic scene. Thank you, Sam. And so the toys are like, cool. Yeah, this seems like a good life. All right. And then the kids go outside for recess. The toys in the box start to argue, and they accidentally spill out of the box onto the floor, where they are given a warm welcome by the other toys of the daycare, including Lotso Huggin Bear, big pink strawberry scented, who assures them that they are in for a great life because new kids are always coming in, so they will never get forgotten. They're never going to be abandoned. What was the name of Jessie's original owner who left her in a box at the bottom of the tree?
Emily.
They're never going to have to go through that Emily situation. So things are looking up, and they're about to get even brighter because this is when we meet Ken.
Wee, 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 wee. Oh, 100%. Also, Ken? Tangent, wee, 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 is Ken's dream house. Also fun.
Event scene, Ken coming down the elevator.
It's the elevator. The way that it's so janky and how it goes down, it's not a smooth elevator. It's perfect. Mm-hmm. It's a toy.
I would argue that almost every Ken scene is a like wee wee event scene. Like I feel like every time he's on screen, I'm just like, this is absolutely perfect.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So we meet Ken. Ken spots Barbie, and I wrote in my notes, this is a moment in our lives. This is Ken meeting Barbie. Dreamweaver, is that the song that comes on?
Yeah.
We just need to take a pause. I don't know what to say here other than Ken meets Barbie, Barbie meets Ken,
and the rest is fate.
Yeah. I think we all aspire to that moment in our own lives. Some of us get it and some of us don't.
A really good example too, and I don't think I've bitched about it on this podcast because Pixar's pretty good at not doing it. But Illumination and other places do it a lot with the needle dropping and like dropping modern songs in their movies. And I typically hate it a lot, but this works. Like this absolutely. Yeah. I'm like, don't bat an eye at it. I'm like, yeah.
Because it wasn't like a modern song, right? It was like
a lot of them aren't, but
lyric,
it is still like a song.
But it was like, it like, underscored the moment rather than like take over it. It wasn't like a blaring, like, oh, you know,
girls want to have fun.
Like, you know, it's not like that. It's just like,
here it was perfect. And it was short. It wasn't like the whole song. It wasn't like a whole sequence. It was like, no, this like makes sense to episode. Like, it's funny. It mm-hmm. added yeah. it added yes. to the humor.
Definitely.
So I was like, yeah, this is like how you do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And we'll get back to those two. But anyways, Andy's toys toured the daycare and they discover that they're basically in this dream world. So there's a battery supply. There are toy repair facilities. There is a Barbie dream home, as has been mentioned. So Lotso leads them through the daycare into this caterpillar room, and it's full of sunlight and color, and he promises them an excellent upcoming play session. So they're all pretty excited. But at this point, Woody is still trying to convince the toys that they need to go back to Andy. But the rest
Woody's being a real Woody about things.
He's being a Woody.
He's being classic Woody.
Like, he's
don't really agree with loyal, what he's saying, right? But like, but he's being Woody about it.
But yeah. he's in his mind, they're Andy's toys. And if Andy put them in the attic. Andy was planning on putting them in the attic because they were his toys. And that's no guarantee of a future. But the potential for a future, certainly. But anyway, so he's like, we got to go back to him. And the others are like, no, we're staying. Buzz offers Woody a handshake. Woody turns his back. Oof.
It's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking.
You think your heart is broken now? Turn around, because Bullseye's following Woody.
Oh, yeah, that hurt.
Woody has to convince him to stay. Sam cries.
Okay, Bullseye's so fucking cute though.
Oh my god, because like, he's everyone's pet. Like, I feel like he's the representation of everyone's pet dog or whatever it is.
Yeah,
so when you look at him, you don't see Bullseye, you see Captain Meatball, you see Lucy, you see Milo and Monty.
I had, this is a tangent, but it's like, I had an ex and we had a dog, and when we broke up, there was like weeks later, he was bringing me the remainder of our stuff, and he brought the dog just like on the walk, and then the dog was like, no, remember, I was like, is it gonna remember me? It was pretty young, and it was like crying the whole way, like as they walked away, and it was like most heartbreaking.
Oh my god.
I know, it was like a very traumatizing life event, and I had to go to work. I was like at work when this happened, and then I went to like I was like serving at the time, and I had to like go upstairs and just like cry, because I was like, oh my god, this dog was just like screaming in the like you know, anyways, yeah. Bullseye, that's what this reminds me of.
For sure.
I have so many questions that I'm not going to ask you.
Okay. Later.
Okay. So Woody makes his way out of the building, and then our little new friend Bonnie walks into him, and she sees him swinging there, and she grabs him and she takes him home.
Do you guys remember what he says when she pulls him down? Isn't it like,
isn't Reach for the Sky? Or
no, I think isn't like, you're my best friend.
You're my favorite deputy.
Something like that. And she's just like, and yeah, she's all cute about it.
She's very sweet. She seems like she's good with toys. I'll just say that.
I would say, like, just really quickly, the whole breakout scene of Woody, like, having to, like, go on the toilet and, like, putting in, like, a single sheet. Like, the attention to detail of Woody breaking out of Sunnyside for the first time is very, very good. It's super cool.
I actually wanted to note this scene as well. I remember watching it and being like, and this is why this is like such a brilliant choice. I mean, I'll refrain from my whole overview or whatever. But to me, I'm like, this is how you use Woody, because like, it's like gag. It's very gag oriented, getting him out of there. Mm. And the animation of him being this floppy doll is like very funny. It's like very funny. He's like this floppy limbed thing. And he's just like flailing all over the place and going fast. And anytime Woody runs, I laugh.
I was laughing a lot. Laura wasn't making any exclamation, but literally any fucking time Woody was just booking it
just
across.
Just running.
And I was I don't know why this is so funny, but it's hilarious.
Yeah. It's like a ragdoll run.
He truly has the best run. Like this. I'm like, yes, this is what we want from Woody in a movie. It's like, I want to watch him do dumb action shit.
It's so frantic. Like, it's so frantic.
And it's funny because I think it's so funny because he's such a serious like Woody character where he's always like wah, 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 and then he's like, running around.
Running
like
Andy.
And it's just so, I remember watching this too and being like, this is brilliant, and like applaud.
Yeah, they know what they're doing, those animators. So back in the caterpillar room, Andy's toys are getting amped for playtime, but they notice that all of the other toys are hiding in anticipation of the children's return. And they're about to learn why, because the bell rings, the kids come in, and chaos ensues. These toys are bitten, they are smashed, they are licked, they are painted, they are glued, they are delimbed. They're destroyed.
That's the one that like got me the most, like, oh, which was when they put Jesse's hair into like the, into paint, the paint, and then just like used her as a paintbrush. Yeah. I'm like, oh no, not
that's
Jesse.
Not, that's not coming out.
Yeah. No.
I feel like this scene is birth control. Like, it's so gross. Accurate. I'm like, oh, children.
They're the worst. They'll ruin your collectibles.
Oh, they're like shoving them up their noses, drooling so all over them. It's so disgusting. Yeah.
They all had like runny, crusty noses and like drool.
Ugh, so many liquids. So we then cut to Woody, who is attending a very civilized tea party in Bonnie's room. And when Bonnie gets up to run to the bathroom, we meet Buttercup, Trixie, and Porcupine, who are... Porcupine has a name, I think, but I don't know his name, who are Bonnie's toys.
Thank you. I didn't want to do it. I was motioning for it's a wee wee.
I saw the motion.
Is it for Trixie?
No.
It's Bonnie's toys. It's Bonnie's toys. I think all of them are like great. Yeah. They're all great.
Yeah.
Like they don't have a lot of screen time, but I think what they have is like, yep, those are great toys. Great
I have a
toys.
Soft spot Agreed. For Trixie because of the scene later on where she's like, that's just a dinosaur down the street.
That's just a dinosaur down the street.
So good. Yeah. So they welcome Woody to the table, and Bonnie has a very lovely kind of tea party play time with her toys.
We do a lot of improv around here.
And they all have good attitudes. Stay relaxed. They're all positive. They all like they're welcoming to Woody, all this good stuff. So it seems like a good situation. And then back at the daycare, the toys are injured. They are exhausted. And Buzz is like, clearly this is a mistake. We are meant to be in the butterfly room. I'm going to talk to Lotso. But when they try and exit the caterpillar room, they realize all of the doors are locked. And so he does kind of a classic Buzz move.
It's very classic. Yeah.
Just jumping, spinning, sliding along this line of paintings through a small open window.
You know, a classic Buzz move, even like after he finds out he's a toy, is still using his freaking wings for no reason. Like, just like,
he's just being cool.
He's just like, I'm just going to pop the wings. Hey, no reason.
If you got it, flaunt it.
Yeah,
and
it's
the,
great.
The
I
wings
love it.
Worked at the end of the first movie.
Yeah,
kind of
you're right.
Glided.
Yeah,
fell with style.
And he so does they, it again do here. Something. Yeah. So he's on this small window. He looks down into the hallway and he kind of notices this crew forming in the hall. So he sees Barbie and Ken, and then he sees these other two toys walking by, and they kind of collect Ken. And so he follows Ken and these two other toys from the hallway into a vending machine. So Buzz kind of sneaks along behind them, climbs up through this vending machine, and he discovers a room full of toys gambling. And as they're gambling, they start to talk about the new toys, aka Andy's toys that have just arrived at the daycare.
But Barbie's different.
Barbie's not with them.
But I'm just saying Ken's like, but Barbie's different.
But Barbie's different, yeah.
Yeah.
I think the bug toy also fucks. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, very muscular. Mrs. Potato.
Yeah, that's
like,
fair.
She was giving him a bit of a feel, wasn't she? But they are shit-talking everyone but Barbie.
Yeah, so they refer to the toys, Andy's toys, as disposable, except for Barbie. So Buzz overhears this, and he's like, I'm out of here. But as he tries to leave... this doll baby finds Buzz, Big Baby, and exposes Buzz to the others. So Big Baby is sort of like Lotso's right hand baby.
Very creepy baby.
And I will say that I had basically that exact same doll. Her name was Pabby, and she also had one eye that was half open and like eyelashes missing and all that stuff. So Baby's very real to me. So she kind of throws Buzz onto the table in front of the others in this gambling room. But then we cut to Bonnie's room. She and her toys are sleeping peacefully, all lined up beside her under the covers, except for Woody, who has never known a moment's peace. And so he like gets up. He's like, I got to get out of there. The other toys wake up. They say, what's going on? He explains his predicament to the other toys. And what's really sweet is rather than the toys, like, who are kind of like his new friends saying, no, you got to stay here. It's safe here. Bonnie's great. They're like, let us help you. So that's going to happen next. But first, we're going to see Buzz being held hostage, taped to a chair, interrogated. And then Lotso walks into the room and Buzz explains what's going on. Lotso is like, oh, my gosh. Yeah, absolutely. Misunderstanding. You can join me in the butterfly room, but the other toys can't.
And he's a keeper.
Yeah.
You hear that, everyone? He's a keeper.
And so Buzz is like, absolutely not. And Lotso says, well, fuck you. That no, he doesn't say that, but basically he says that. Yeah.
Could you imagine? Yeah.
He literally basically
he commands him. Yeah, he commands him back into the hostage chair and he pulls out Buzz's manual. And at Lotso's instruction, this is actually like the dark moments you were alluding to earlier. This is pretty dark. The other toys bust open his back panel and they switch Buzz back to factory setting.
Demo mode.
So yeah. You may remember in Toy Story 2 when our Buzz meets the Buzz in Al's toy barn. That was basically factory setting Buzz, right? So this Buzz has now become that Buzz. He's lost all of his memory. So then we check in on the other toys in the caterpillar room. Mrs. Potato Head left one of her eyes behind in Andy's room, and she's starting to see visions from that other eye back home. And she witnesses Andy and his mom talking about the garbage bag of toys, and she realizes, oh my God, he really did want us to go into the attic. So this is sort of like, oh, the toys realized Woody was telling the truth. Andy didn't want to throw them out. And kind of right at that moment, Lotso walks in and says to Andy's toys, y'all aren't leaving. Y'all aren't going home. Y'all aren't going anywhere. You're staying here. And my new guy, factory setting Buzz, is going to stop you if he needs to. So Andy's toys are all put into bins, which are essentially jail cells. They are locked up for the night, except for Mr. Potato Head, who is brought to the box. Which
is solitary confinement.
Solitary confinement.
Watching it now, I was like, oh man, this is like bumming me out a little.
Yeah.
It is a prison break movie though, so it makes sense to have it in there.
Which I did, I like forgot or like never realized. And then I was like, yeah, okay, it's a prison break movie. But also like, I don't know, the solitary confinement bit and using it for humor, I was like, oh man, this is a fucking kid's movie.
Mr. Potato Head, a sandbox, and a couple of Lincoln logs.
I don't think those are Lincoln logs.
Yeah.
Also, when you were talking about the eye, it just reminded me of a throwaway joke earlier that I thought was really funny because they were talking about going to the attic and they're like, oh, we can hang with all the Christmas toys. And they were like,
they're fun.
They're fun. Yeah.
That was so funny.
Yeah. That was a good one. Yeah. And I mean, this is also a bit of a breaking point for our new celebrity couple, Barbie and Ken, because this is when Barbie kind of realizes that Ken is bad news. He is one of Lotso's cronies. So things overall for Andy's crew are not looking good, except they are for Woody back at Bonnie's house, because the toys are helping Woody successfully locate Andy's home around the corner, which is where we get this cute joke from Trixie, who's like, oh, that's nothing. That's just me talking. That's just that's just the dinosaur down the street. And they realize that Andy's home is right around the corner from Bonnie's. And so Andy's ready to make a break for it. On his way out, he casually drops a reference to Sunnyside, and it's like he dropped a bomb. And the other toys are like, Sunnyside? Oh, geez, that's a bad news place. And this is when Chuckles the Clown is introduced. So this is another one of Bonnie's toys. And Chuckles the Clown shares the story of how he, Lotso, and Baby were left behind at the side of the road by their human, Daisy. Not on purpose. It was an misunderstanding, but this sort of created a shift in Lotso where he was like, no, we have got to make it home, kind of that same determination that we often see in Woody. But when Lotso and Baby and Chuckles got back to Daisy's home, they discovered that Lotso had been replaced by a new Lotso, like, Huggin' Bear.
Pretty
that's tough.
Like that, I feel like, yeah, that is that would make you a villain. That's pretty heartbreaking.
Yeah, it's a strong origin story.
This is kind of what, yes. So this is like somewhat of a hot take, but like I really think like Lotso is such a well thought out villain for this movie. Yeah. Like he's a legit, he's really well written, and I think he's like he's perfect for this type of movie, right?
And despite the fact that Lotso was the only toy that had been replaced, he insisted that Baby and Chuckles had also been replaced. And they were like, no, we want to stay. He's like, no.
I think it's like
it's
cold. It's kind of cold how everyone throws it back in his face, though. Because everyone's like,
yeah,
only you got replaced. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, man, like, you're not making him any less of a villain with that attitude.
No, 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 it's true.
So it's a rough moment. But basically, Lotso forces Baby and Chuckles to leave with him, and they end up at Sunnyside. But Lotso was a changed toy at that point.
And how does Chuckles leave?
I assume that Bonnie just brought him home from there.
That's kind of what they said. She found him. He got lucky, is what he was basically saying. Mm-hmm.
And so this makes Woody realize that, like, it's not just about getting home to Andy. He's got to help his friends. So morning arrives at the daycare, and Lotso and company come barreling into the caterpillar room to pick up Buzz and deliver this sandy, traumatized Mr. Potato Head. But who else is in the caterpillar room but Woody? He has returned in Bonnie's backpack. Nobody knows yet. But this is when Woody actually witnesses the horror of the caterpillar room. So he's like, oh, God, I got to do something. And then behind him, we hear this character who's, the subtitles refer to it as chatter phone. So like that little phone on wheels.
Yeah. We see him earlier, but we don't get any interaction. Exactly. He just kind of shows up.
Yeah,
like,
he's like a cutie pie.
It's like a little eerie.
I think he's cute.
Well, yeah. So like he is in that new low budget, very successful horror movie Skinamarink. So I can't really see the character the same because they use that legit same type of toy as a scare tactic in that movie. And it has that creepy face and they use it as like a jump scare. And I'm like, oh, he is pretty creepy easily. He's kind of like...
Woody first shows up in this movie. Yeah, because he doesn't talk. He just kind of comes up to Woody and Woody kind of like brushes him aside. The
phone
first
like rings. Like he goes up to Woody and rings his phone, but Woody's just like, brushes him aside.
He's the seasoned prison inmate because he's always they'll never break me.
Yeah, he's that trope, but I also think that Wii U.
Really?
Yeah, I
think the phone guy he's trying to warn them. He's like really looking out for them.
It's true.
He's hardened, but he like, you know, he's trying. He's trying to help them.
He knows. He's respectable. He knows the potential consequences of him helping them.
He knows how to get out. Yeah, he knows the whole plan.
So
So
he hears Chatterphone and Chatterphone's kind of like, pick me up. So Woody picks up the phone and this is how the charter phone communicates. So the phone tells him there's only one way out, the garbage can. Woody's like, please help me.
The garbage chute.
Thank you. What did I say? Garbage can. No, it's a chute. So Woody's like, please help me. So phone gives him the down low, locks, walls, patrols. And of course, the monkey.
That monkey is so creepy.
Yeah, that monkey's very creepy. So it's recess time. The room gets quieter. Woody reveals himself to Andy's other toys and shares his plan. And then we flash forward to nighttime and roll call. Potato Head has been replaced by an actual potato, but it's a diversion in order to get into the box, the sandbox. So Mr. Potato Head actually is like, wants to get into the sandbox, but... it's part of the plan. It's fine. And then Slink sneaks out of his and some of the other toys sneak out too. But Slink goes to help Woody. Barbie calls Ken over, begs him to take her back, begs him. And Ken is like still in love with her, obviously, because she's Barbie and he's Ken. So he's like, OK, but yeah, OK, come on. Like, I'll show you my closet. And then we have this amazing scene.
Amazing.
Where Ken shows Barbie his closet and Barbie's like super into it. She asked him to model a few outfits.
It's an incredible scene. Just like all of Ken's outfits and how fucking stoked he is to wear it. It brings me so much joy. It's very funny.
Yeah. Yep. So while that's happening and Barbie's kind of distracting Ken, Woody and Slink are trying to take out the monkey. So this is what yeah. Chatterphone warned us about, was this monkey, because he's like security guy. He's got eyes on all the cameras. And this is with hilarious results. So it turns into a big tussle. Monkey ends up scotch tape in a drawer. And Woody and Slink retrieve the key that they're in there to get as they tape up monkey. Back in Caterpillar room, I think Barbie gives a signal for him and Rex to start fighting. And so as they're fighting, they kind of knock over their cage and they end up trapping Buzz, who's there standing guard, in a tub. And so they're on top of it, keeping Buzz trapped in this tub. And then Jesse grabs a leftover tortilla, slides it under the door.
Love that that was part of the plan. Yeah. Like, that was like part of the...
Yeah,
like,
absolutely. How did you know that was... They were like, we need something for Potato Head, but a potato won't fit under the door, so we need a tortilla. And then Potato Head's limbs have climbed out of the sandbox and have made it to the tortilla. And we'll leave that for a second. That's just sort of happening in the background. Do we have to leave
it? Because it's a wee-o, that tortilla.
Oh, no, actually, it does happen.
Tortilla, so Potato Head bucks?
Tortilla.
Plug the limbs plug themselves into tortilla and become Tortilla Head. Mr. Tortilla Head.
Bucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bucks. Oh, 1,000%. Absolutely.
Yeah. For sure.
Although, he's pretty limp. So back in Barbie's dream house, Ken is still trying on outfits and feeling really good, but Barbie takes advantage of him having his guard down and attacks. And she's trying to force him to tell her how to fix Buzz. And in order to do so, she starts to tear apart Ken's clothes. This hurt to watch. As a fan of fashion, of clothing.
Sequins are tacky. They're not even in anymore.
This was rough. So Ken cracks as fast as I would have and tells her what happened. Barbie retrieves the manual, brings it to Woody. Meanwhile, Tortilla Head encounters a pigeon and turns into tortilla strips. So that's kind of happening. The toys that have pinned down Buzz. So he busts out of the tub, but then they pin him down and they attempt to restore him to custom settings. But instead, they restore him to Spanish language settings.
Oh, yeah.
So that's going to be fun.
Oh,
yeah.
Sam and I know. We have an eye for these things, everyone.
Yep.
That's why you never hear Brad and Laura do it.
It's true.
Yes, indeed. So we now have Spanish language Buzz, but we don't have time to fix him because we got to get outside. We got to reunite with Jesse and Mrs. Potato Head. But then as they get outside, Spanish Buzz spots Jesse, and it's a little bit of a Barbie Ken moment. He declares his love for her. And then, of course, Mr. Tortilla Head had been destroyed, and instead Mr. Cucumber Head appears. And he's then restored into finally Mr. Potato Head's original form. So the toys make a run for it, but Woody, Buzz, and the aliens are left behind. And then they're kind of like, baby comes out and is about to catch them.
Baby's on a creepy swing.
Yes, baby's on a creepy swing.
Looking at the moon.
And baby, baby hears them and almost catches them. And then they manage another escape. So while this is happening, Buzz puts the moves on Jesse. And then she kind of lights up when Woody and the others make it over. And Buzz is like, oh, she's into this guy. This guy's my enemy. So Spanish Buzz has it out for Woody. But Buzz is ready to show off, so he opens the garbage chute and they all slide down. They're almost out. They're almost safe. And then at the last minute, of course, Lotso appears. So we learn that Lotso's gang got the plan out of Chatterphone, and Chatterphone paid for it. Poor little guy.
Oh, my God. They broke him.
Beat up. Yeah. Broke him.
And at the same time, the garbage truck is on its way down the street. Flashback to the beginning of the movie when the garbage truck was coming for the toys at Andy's house. And so Lotso basically gives them an ultimatum. They can go back to the Caterpillar room or they can get in the garbage. And this is when Ken has a moment of redemption and he stands up to Lotso and he's like, no, you're wrong, Lotso. You're not a nice guy. I'm with them. And
see, this is when I would say Ken
this is
now
when Ken.
Fucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's
he fucked just all like, along.
Yeah. I agree with Sam.
He was a patsy because, the whole time. Now well, is yeah. when he finally steps up and like takes his life into his own hands.
He fucked, but he was a villain. And now he fucks, but he's okay.
And he believes in monogamy because they're like, but there's a lot of Barbies out there. And he looks at Barbies and is like, not to me, there isn't.
She melts.
I actually forgot because we didn't bring up this specific scene, but when Barbie, I think this is where it is, but Barbie steals Ken's clothes. This is
so good.
Being a downer as I often am on this podcast. Yeah. But like, okay, so Barbie escapes in Ken's clothes and they're like, oh yeah, there goes Ken. But then they see the heels. I don't know. I think it's Bookworm or somebody sees Barbie going off and they basically like, are like, oh, like fucking Ken wearing heels.
They just assume it's Ken wearing heels.
They think it's Ken, but he's in heels and they're like a dick about it. And then there's another joke like that later that might be in the credits or somewhere else where they're like, oh, like,
that's Ken's writing. Ken's writing.
Yeah, oh, Ken's writing. Ken's really righty. And I'm just like, well, I don't like these jokes.
Yeah, same.
I think like,
I didn't like the heels one.
I think overall, it's pretty harmless compared to some other things that Disney as a whole has done in the past. But like, yeah, it's good to call it out, I guess. But I really don't like Ken writing.
I don't think we need to make fun of people for girly handwriting.
The girly handwriting one is like, it's toxic masculinity.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what it is. And it's reinforcing that. So I'm just like,
Ken signs his like name with a heart and stuff like that.
And it's just like, I think the only issue is that like, it's a face that Woody makes. And part of me is like,
they react to it very poorly.
Yeah, sure. He could have just been like, ooh, he has great writing kind of thing.
Yeah.
They do say that. Exactly. And then they, that's not Ken. Or that's not Barbie, it's Ken.
But let's get back to the present because we are on the edge of a garbage can. It's a life or death situation. Yes. So they get this ultimatum. Ken has this moment of redemption. And this is when Lotso goes off on a rant and is like, no kid has ever loved a toy. And this is when Woody kind of pokes him. He rubs a little salt in the wound. He says, what about Daisy?
Does he poke the bear?
He pokes the bear. And he reminds Lotso and Baby, who's there too, of Daisy's love. And that was all it took for Baby, because Baby then picks up Lotso and throws him in the garbage can. And we're like, oh, snap.
Because Lotso broke the little like tag that said Daisy on it. Yeah. And Baby was like, mama.
Mama.
Yeah. Oh. So it was a whole thing.
And so the toys make a run for it. But one of the alien toys gets stuck. And of course, Woody goes to save him. But then as he does, Lotso pulls Woody into the garbage can. The toys then try to save Woody. And they all end up in the dumpster. And within the dumpster, they kind of end up getting dumped out at the garbage plant. At the dump. Thank you. Dumped at the dump. Jessie's trapped, but Buzz saves her. But then Buzz gets crushed by a TV. And somehow this restores his custom settings. Thank goodness. So at the dump, the aliens get plowed. And soon the rest of the toys get plowed. And they all end up on this conveyor belt. And then there's this magnet in the ceiling. And because Slinky has metal parts, he gets sucked up to the ceiling, and they're all like, oh no, we have to save you. But then they all realize, no, there's this like compactor destroyer spinny thing up ahead. We got to avoid that at all costs. We need to get on the ceiling. So they all grab on metal things, and Rex is kind of the last one to get it. And they're all on the ceiling. They're all safe. But then Lotso appears asking for help. And of course, Woody's going to save him because he's got a savior complex. So Woody and Buzz get him out up to the ceiling just in time.
I do love that, though. I love that Woody goes, but I do love that Buzz follows shortly after. Yeah. Like, it's such a, like, it's just like, Woody and Buzz. Yeah, they're such good bros.
So they're up on the ceiling just in time. And then they all kind of like get through this thrasher thing safely. They all drop down back into the shredded garbage. And then up ahead, Rex is like, oh, daylight. Nope, it's not daylight, everyone. It's not daylight. Be careful. It's fire. And then they're all like, swim away. So they try to run back, but it's no use. And then as they head towards it, Lotso is like, oh, there's a button up there that says stop. Lotso's the furthest back, so they've got to help him get there. So Woody kind of helps Lotso climb up this ladder to reach it. But then Lotso is once again like, fuck you. And
where's your kid now, Sheriff?
Yeah, double crosses them, does not hit the stop button, runs away. And the gang surges toward the incinerator, and with no options in sight, they accept their inevitable fate by clasping hands and going together towards the light.
This moment is goddamn
iconic. This is an event.
This
moment.
Is the event.
I cannot believe this moment exists in a kid's film or a Toy Story film in general. But like, my God, do you feel like when you're watching it, you feel like things are ending. It's very dire.
We're dying.
And
we're about to die.
But there is a beautiful sadness to the moment too.
It's the acceptance.
Because yeah, there's an acceptance in everybody, because this movie really hits home that these toys are family. They're Andy's toys, but all of them stick together and they are family. So the fact they all just struggle to reach for each other's hands in the final moments, like including like Rex reaching, like his tiny little arms reaching for Ham's hand,
that's all
and
they
like
can do.
And then Buzz, who got rejected by Woody at the beginning of the movie to like get a handshake out of him, mm-hmm. he reaches for Woody, and it's just like a whole, oh, it's so powerful.
They're not scared of it either. They like linger on this for so long,
they
like this moment.
It.
Yeah, mm-hmm. like this moment. They, like you said, they like scroll through all of them. They're not just like, okay, yeah, the toys have a moment where they think they're gonna die. It's like a very long moment where you're like, oh wait, mm-hmm. are they gonna die? Because like you go through all of them and it's like slow and you're like seeing their faces like change, and the like animation and stuff is just incredible, where you're seeing them go from like really trying to fight this to accepting
and
this.
Woody's and, the last person to like give up on it, because Woody if anything else he always fucking tries as much as he can, so he's the last one trying to crawl his way out, and then he's just like, Buzz is like, it's time, buddy.
I don't think we've seen that kind of depiction of accepting death in that way. Like, it's very dark.
It's quite something.
I like to think that we too would remain calm in the face of the incinerator.
I would fucking wail and scream. Help me! I might get off.
Yeah, trying to run behind you. Like, get me out of here!
Screaming for Lotso. Yeah.
At the end, all you can do is hold each other, which I feel like is like a trope. Like, I mean, they do it in like, what's that? Don't Look Up. They're like all having dinner and they sit around and they're like, okay, like we're going to be together in this moment. Yeah. And I feel like that the idea of when things turn out the bleakest, it's just like your family that keeps you together.
Yeah, totally.
But then a light appears in the sky. It's the claw.
We get the final character who fucks.
I honestly, during this whole moment, couldn't, as much as I was like, I've seen this movie so many times and like whatever, I was like, oh fuck, how did they get out of this again? Same. Like, I forget.
The claw appears above them and plucks them from the pile, and we learn that the alien toys have become the master of the claw. The toys make it out, and now they must get home to Woody. So after a quick spray down in the yard, they climb up Slink into Andy's room.
Oh, sorry. Before that, you see Lotso's fate, right? You do.
Okay, yes.
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
Like, they get out. They're like, oh, the attic wouldn't be so bad.
Lotso,
and then you see Lotso's fate.
Is found at the side of the road by a garbage truck that picks him up. The driver picks him up and says, hey, I used to have one of these, and sticks him in his front grill with a collection of other unfortunate toys.
It is weird that he like stopped his truck to be like, oh, I had that toy before. And then, it is. Yeah, strange.
I feel like it's also weird that he has stuffed animals strapped to the front of his truck.
I know.
It's
weird.
And as they hit the road, the more experienced toys warn him to keep his mouth closed.
Yeah.
So that will be...
Close your mouth, buddy.
That's his fate, is trying not to eat bugs for eternity. Sorry, Lotso. I prefer the villain's fate from Toy Story 2. Where he's fated to be played with for the rest of his life.
Mm.
Poor guy. He thought he wanted to be a collectible. He'll learn love soon enough. Anyways, so the toys make it home, spray down.
You got it. But I wanted to mention, I forgot to go back and check, but when they come back to Andy's room, there's the outside shot where they're going along the peak of the roof. Mm. And I'm like, pretty sure... At least in the second movie, maybe in the first, you see them always leaving Andy's room, but you never see them come back in that shot. But it's like a reuse of that shot, and they're like going back to Andy's room now. So it's all full circle.
That is sweet. Yeah. And I remember in the second movie, they all climb down Slink, and like he'll go down, get the next one, go down. And then on the last one, he grabs his butt and he goes down.
Yeah.
They like Brad said, full circle, they're climbing up Slink to get into Andy's room, and they hop into a box bound for the attic. Woody says his goodbyes to the other toys. They get in the attic box. He climbs into the college box. We see Andy and his mom sharing a moment as they enter his childhood bedroom for the last time, because when he returns, he will no longer be a child. He's going to be an adult.
She also like really made him pack his room away. Like, is he ever coming back again? I feel like when I left for college, I just took like a suitcase with clothes and like some posters and shit. Yeah. But she like made him like clean his room out. Like, hey, he's never coming back.
Andy's mom deserves her home gym. Okay.
I think that's what's happening. Yeah.
So as he's watching Andy and his mom hug goodbye, Woody has this moment of realizing that he doesn't want to leave the other toys. In the way that Andy and his mom are talking about each other, he realized like the toys are really his family. So with his last few seconds, he scribbles this note on a post-it and sticks it on top of the box of Andy's toys. And Woody then kind of goes off screen and Andy sees this note and he's like, okay. And he takes the toys, he puts them in his car, and he drives to Bonnie's house.
Can Andy not tell what his own mother's handwriting looks like? Or does Woody have the same handwriting as the mom?
Both are possible, Brad. Both are possible.
Woody
in the
has
world
seen
of Toy
Andy's
Story.
Mom's handwriting for years now. Maybe he's mastered
That's
it.
Fair.
Who knows?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Fair enough. We'll go with that.
So when Andy arrives at Bonnie's house, he gets there, he says hello, and he puts the box of toys down, and then he proceeds to introduce each of them to Bonnie. He describes why he loves them and what makes them special, one at a time. And then in the bottom of the box, he spots Woody. And of course, Bonnie recognizes Woody. She calls him my cowboy, but Andy doesn't understand how Woody got there, because Andy... last he remembered, he had put Woody in his college box, right? So he's kind of like holding this beloved toy that he had planned to bring him with him to college, sitting there with this little girl who he kind of realizes that she can give him a better life than Andy going away to college. And he realizes that it's time to say goodbye. And I'm going to read straight from the script here, where Andy describes Woody to Bonnie. He says, "Now Woody, he's been my pal as long as I can remember. He's brave like a cowboy should be, and kind and smart. But the thing that makes Woody special is he'll never give up on you, ever. He'll be there for you no matter what. You think you can take care of him for me?" And he gives Woody to Bonnie.
Wow. I would have loved to have seen Sam deliver that.
Yeah. She couldn't do it.
Kind of tearing
no,
up.
No, I couldn't. Yeah.
And then just when we think that we've taken all the emotional gut punches we can, Andy picks up Ham and he starts playing with all of his toys one last time.
One last time.
And we get this beautiful montage of their old owner, their old human, and their new human playing together with them for the last time and for the first time. And then as the sun goes down, Andy gets in his car. He looks over at his toys and Bonnie and says, "Thanks, guys." And he pulls away. And that's it.
Well, no. Woody says, "So long,
partner."
They all get up as Andy's driving away and they say, "So long, partner." And it's a huge moment. And then it's just like, obviously, like, here are the new toys. Let's get excited about life again. But it's like
a huge moment for the toys. But I feel like the emotional thing for me is like Andy, like, he's like the idea to me of like giving up a toy is like as someone who holds on to things and stuff, like how hard it would be to let go of that. Like, him giving up Woody to me is just like absolutely insane for one, but like that's so hard, and you're like literally letting go of like a whole like phase of your life, and like that's just like a scary thing to do. And I think for Andy to do that, I think that's the emotional moment. I'm like, yeah, it's probably sad for the toys, but I always felt more like the Andy side, where I'm like, oh man, like you're going to start a new chapter.
Yes. And I think like the fact that they aged Andy up for this film,
and
the fact that this was the end of the trilogy and you're saying goodbye felt like a very final goodbye. Yeah. You are Andy in this moment.
Yeah, we grew up with him.
It's a unique moment in that we never see a perspective that's not toys. Like, we never see human perspective in this film, but in that final moment, we're in Andy's perspective. Mm. And like, truly we are.
Yeah. And it leaves you, it like leaves you there as much as like Woody says, so long, partner, and stuff. It's like that end scene is kind of like Andy's scene, which, yeah, we don't usually linger on.
Well, yeah, like you were saying, Laura, it's always been the toys' perspective, but in a way, the trilogy has always been like Andy's trilogy. So this is him like saying goodbye to his adolescence and moving on to other things. And yeah, it's all very, I don't know, smoky. You get smoky eyed.
He was always like, so like, oh no, where's Woody and all the other movies? Like, he's losing his toys. So for him to be the one being like, I'm giving them away now, is like,
But to like, it's so beautiful, because I have so much to say about the scene. I'll save it for when we talk about like our feelings of the movie as a whole. But like, to call back to like how Andy plays with his toys and how like Andy puts Woody on his shoulders like he does in those original movies. It's like he's so big now. Woody doesn't fit around his shoulders the same way, but he's playing with these toys.
He's so happy.
And like to see, like, it's so interesting because like these toys are so emotive when they are in their regular toy form and they're just talking to each other. But what, like, cause like Woody's like a stoic face when he's just having his like just regular smile without being whatever, you know exactly how these toys are feeling, even though they're not actually emoting anymore. You can tell that all these toys are so fucking stoked to finally play with Andy, and you don't even see them change facial expressions the entire time. And I think that's just, it says a lot about all of that. And oh, it's beautiful.
And that's Toy Story 3, my friends.
Wow. Yeah. And then the final shot is the pan up to the clouds. Yeah. And I'm pretty sure that's like the first shot, basically, of
it is,
the first movie.
End
like
of
the
this
wallpaper.
One. Yeah.
End of this one. Yeah. Full circle. Well, beautiful. Anything else for the summary, Laura?
No, that's, I mean, there's some post credit scenes, but I won't get
they're
into it.
They're just
those.
Fun.
Yeah. They're
like
fun.
Even like the Spanish, You Got a Friend in Me is very fun. I think that's a great way to end it.
They had to add some laughs after.
Oh, yeah.
The emotional gut punches. Well, beautiful, beautiful summary. Beautiful movie all around. Very good. So, well, I guess we'll jump right to you then, Tungs. You were already talking about what you think of the movie. Like, do you want to continue going on?
Oh, yeah, all right, I'll go.
Your thoughts?
I know we have the rest of the podcast to go, so I won't fucking like keep going on this. I think this movie, like, I love this movie. I always tell people I love this movie, but I think I forgot how much I love this movie. Like, take for granted how much I love this movie, because like, if people ask for my favorite movies these days, I'll say something current like Spider-Verse, Everything All Everywhere All at Once, that type of stuff. And I forget like how much this movie like made me who I am today in a way. Like I said before, this franchise is so important to me, and to see the full circleness of this movie, like they bring everything back. There are so many references to the original Toy Stories and to my nostalgia that hits all the right things without having to pander and talk down to me as an audience member. And like the fact that like it is a full adventure, the prison break stuff's amazing. The moments of like the incinerator, the ending, like the whole ending of like once Andy pulls up to Bonnie's house, like I immediately started welling up because I knew exactly what was going to happen. And I legit cried last night. Like I tear up in a lot of Pixar movies, but Toy Story 3 makes me cry. Like it's so beautiful and touching, and there's just so much emotion that takes over me that I'm just like, I fucking love this movie. And like, I love how they also, we talk about the core like seven or seven-ish toys that like that we all love in Toy Story 2 when they all go on that heist, they go Big Al's toy barn and stuff like that. But in this movie, they all like work together. They all show their strengths in really fun ways. We see everyone working at the best of their capabilities. Buzz being super athletic, Woody taking charge and like having the ideas, Potato Head finally having moments where he's like doing cool shit. Mrs. Potato Head has her whole eye thing. Rex comes, everybody has their moment in this movie, which makes things really special. And it doesn't make it feel like these are just characters just left to the side. It's not just Woody and Buzz's story. It's all of these Andy's toys, which I think is really cool. And like how they just hammer home the ideas of love and family and moving on and growing up is a very Toy Story thing. So again, I can go on, but like honestly, this movie to me is the best of the Toy Story movies easily, and I fucking love it. So yeah,
nice. That's we'll discuss.
Yeah, we will, Brad. Sounds like we have things to talk about, but go ahead.
Laura, yeah. After your beautiful summary, what did you think of the movie?
I thought it was great.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great movie. It'll get you.
It's like there's a knife to your throat or something.
Is there a butt? It's a great movie, but
it'll get you.
Yeah. Well, I feel like Laura's holding back.
It will get you.
It's a strange way to talk about Toy Story.
And
but
it got me. It got me.
Laura's not really good. So here's the thing is people at home, Laura's not really good at talking about her emotions very well. So when she says things like this, usually you can infer that she really liked it. So that's what I'm taking from this. Yes?
It got me.
Okay.
Okay, Sam, what'd you think of Toy Story 3?
Yeah, it's my favorite by far. I like that, like, every moment of this movie matters in a way that I won't look away. Like, I'm never bored. I'm like, everything kind of is like driving the main story, and it's just all like always moving. And I love just like how funny it is. And I feel like they're like really playing to the strengths. We kind of already talked about Woody's animation, but just like, there's so many moments in this movie that just make me laugh. I like that it's not afraid to get dark. The monkey shit like kills me. I love that fucking monkey. And I also love, we skipped over this part where Buzz is spying and he sees Barbie and Ken and they're just talking and the dumbest shit. And they're like, I love you. Yeah. He's like, see, this time you said love.
Yeah. That is really it's different every time.
I there's so many parts of this movie that make me laugh. So I feel like as far as like an enjoyable experience of watching a movie, like I will watch this movie many more times, I'm sure, in my life. So
how many times did you cry, Sam?
Not as much as I thought.
The incinerator didn't get me this time.
The incinerator? And the end, I think. Were the only
those are the two. Those are the two.
Bullseye things. Almost got me.
I could see that. Yeah. Like, yeah, Bullseye, like trailing.
I forgot
Woody.
That moment.
I think it's really the ending, which is like the big one, right? The incinerator, you're scared for these toys. You're mm-hmm. like, I can't believe this is the end. But like the ending is just, there's a, it's very poignant.
Have you
seen I think the incinerator got me more this time than the end. I feel like it flip-flops for me because especially when I know it's coming, like I feel like the more I watch a movie, like when this first came out, I probably, not that you get numb to it, but I'm like, okay, it'll be harder to make me cry this time. Like I know exactly what I'm getting into, but this time, like it has been a few like years since I've seen it. And so like both moments like got me a mm-hmm. fair bit, but that I don't know, the incinerator, I feel like the older I get, the more these weird deathy things get me. So that one I was like, ooh, like embracing, I feel like it was like Up, like I mean we all heard me break down in Up, but like I feel like anything to do with like getting old and like that kind of stuff like fucks with me a little. So yeah,
this is just a yes no question, I'm saving it, but have you two seen Toy Story 4?
Okay. Yes.
We'll talk about
I
it.
Think we saw that one. Mm. Yeah,
we'll talk about it. We'll talk about it.
We can leave it. Just curious. Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, everybody liked it. I feel like I might have led you all down maybe the wrong path because I really like Toy Story 3. I don't think I've seen it since I saw it the first time, but a lot of the moments really stuck with me. Like the Spanish Buzz, the incinerator, I do remember mm-hmm. getting me the first time. Not as much this time, but it hit really hard the first time from what I remember. But that ending always is like super emotional. Just that like, yeah, the loss of childhood innocence and moving on from like playtime to being like, oh, I got to go to college. I got to get a job. I got to start doing bills and all that shit.
And you know what? I'm just going to interrupt for a second, Brad, and keep going. But like, I think mm-hmm. what's beautiful about that scene is the entire movie, these toys were basically like, and Woody just being like, convincing everyone to be like, Andy still loves us. Andy still loves us. And everyone's like, yeah, I guess he's one of us, put us in the attic and whatever, whatever. But to see him actually take each toy one by one and say why these toys are so special, that's what really got me. It's just like he's actually like the moment where he just like uses Jesse's arm to be like, she's the routin' countin'est cowboy and a cowgirl. And this is her trusty steed Bullseye and Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head. And they're in love and they should always be together. Like the fact that he spends those few seconds to explain why these toys are really special. And that's what I was saying before, is like you don't see these toys' reactions for mm-hmm. him saying that, but you can feel what they're feeling in that moment, which I think is special. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I think that's beautiful as well, because I, again, relating this more to Andy, where it's just kind of showing that you can love people and leave them behind. Not in a like dark and sad way, but like people move through chapters in your life and it doesn't diminish how much you love them. And I think this kind of send off is just like really nice. I've seen a lot of things online talk about like how things always have to be forever to be meaningful. And it's just like, no, that's all kind of bullshit. It's like mm-hmm. these toys and this. So for him to, I think for him to go through them individually and be like, this is exactly what I loved about you is just such a beautiful way of being like, you did matter and you always will. And it just like me leaving doesn't like, I'm telling you exactly what I loved about you. And I think that's really just nice.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He Marie Kondo'd it. He gave thanks. He thanked it for its time.
He did.
Set it free.
Don't do that.
But yeah, that I would. Yeah, I feel like that whole part. Yeah, I would agree. And it's also it's funny how like their personalities are the personalities that Andy pictures for them. Like Woody is the cowboy that never gives up, and like Jesse and Bullseye and all that stuff. So yeah, no, that whole thing's really beautiful. I do think it's a really good culmination of all three movies, seeing a lot of full circle stuff, a lot of callbacks, you know, Andy getting older. Yeah, it's a really good end to a trilogy for sure. So those are my thoughts. I really liked it. I would watch it again. So
yeah,
there's my stamp of approval. But speaking of such a soulful movie with so much feeling, it must have come from a place of like people really caring and wanting to make another. But no, you'd be wrong. Disney demands money and more products. So I would like to get into source material for us all. So when Disney originally joined with Pixar, way back at the beginning of the first Toy Story, in the deal, Toy Story got the rights to all characters and movies up to Cars, I think. So that's when the deal changed. So it was like a 7-picture deal or something like that. So Disney owned all the rights to any sequels, characters, all that stuff. But Pixar retained the right to refuse to work on the sequels. So it wouldn't be an official Pixar movie, but Disney could make more. And of course, Disney was like, yo, I'm seeing dollar signs in my eyes. We can make more money off this. So Disney was going to make their own sequel, Toy Story 3, with a studio called Circle 7 Animation, which I guess was their 3D. I didn't really look into it, but I assume that this was their 3D studio versus their 2D studio, maybe something along those lines. So they came up with Circle 7 Animation came up with 2 pitches. I'm not going to go fully into them because honestly, they're kind of like convoluted and I don't really understand what they were trying to pitch, but I'll try to give my best quick summary. So the first one was Andy and his toys, the main little crew. They go to his grandmother's house for the night because his room is getting remodeled. And then so a set of Andy's toys and new characters are trying to figure out who stole the toys one by one in a whodunit murder mystery. But I got very confused reading this because I was like, but Andy has his toys. So what toys were stolen? I can see why this pitch was denied because I don't understand what's going on. Second pitch after that one was, and this is like a whole paragraph. In our industry, we have elevator pitches where you're supposed to just pitch something in one sentence. This is not one sentence. Basically, the gist of it is Buzz starts malfunctioning, so Andy sends it to Taiwan to get fixed.
I already hate it. Sounds like the plot of Cars 2.
Yeah, and then while all the other toys are searching on the internet, they discover that way more toys are malfunctioning, so they fear for Buzz's destruction, so they all ship themselves to Taiwan on a rescue adventure for Buzz, and Buzz beats a whole bunch of characters. One of the new characters would be one that would like be the toy that replaces Buzz in their world, which was, Dax Blaster, who, get this, had an accessory pet cat named Comet. Seems a little bit maybe familiar for some future movies. So these pitches, they get kind of like scrapped for Lightyear. So this falls through, the deals all change. I don't know, business. So things end up back with Pixar, and Pixar is like, we're gonna kind of try to do our own thing for Toy Story 3. We've already got an idea that we've been kicking around for a while.
It's way better than the other ones.
Yeah, they were like, no offense to that other company, but we're just gonna do our own thing. So they went to a cabin. This is like the core original crew, like Lasseter and all of those main first Grinch. People that did all the movies.
Doctor.
Yeah. So they went to a cabin where I guess they first pitched the first Toy Story, which I don't remember us talking about that, but that seems kind of cool. And they immediately, almost immediately dropped that idea because they were like, this idea sucks. Then
the idea of going to a cabin?
No, their idea that they were like, we've got an idea kicking around. Oh, okay. But, and then they pitched it and they were like, this idea sucks. So apparently they were discouraged that they didn't think of something on the very first day. So instead, they rewatched the first two Toy Story movies. And then the idea started to take shape from there that it's a continuation. And Andy grows up and Stanton wrote the treatment for that. So their pitch, which I don't have to summarize because it's a proper pitch, is Woody the cowboy and his toy box friends are dumped in a daycare center after their owner, Andy, leaves for college. Done.
Perfect.
That's perfect. Now that's how you make a pitch.
Why did I do the summary? That's so much better.
Because we like making these podcasts long for whatever reason.
To get in all those sponsor breaks.
Yeah. That's how Toy Story 3 came to be. Kind of an interesting whole business.
That
is,
I did not know any of that. So that was really cool.
Yeah.
So we're going to skip ahead now into Pixar particulars with our very own Miss Tomato Head over here.
Tomato Head.
Tomato Head.
Mrs. Tomato Head. Mrs.
Tomato Head. Mrs. Tomato Head to you. Yeah, I'll blast through these in lieu of time. And I actually, there wasn't that many to be had this time. Like, I often go to IMDb and stuff. I did end up looking at other sources because there was really not that many of note anyway that I thought were interesting. So the first one here is just that Tom Hanks and Tim Allen insisted they record their lines together, which is not really that common for animated movies. People can do it from wherever, like remotely, and they competent together later, but they love the chemistry of their characters on screen together so much. And I guess they did it for a bit in the first movie that they were like, no, we want to come in studio and do these together. So that's kind of cute. When Woody, this is like a fun little Easter eggy one. When Woody tries to change Buzz back to normal mode, if you look at the batteries inside, they're the brand of the batteries is By and Large, which is from Wall-E.
Right.
That's fun.
That kind of gives me heebie-jeebies.
A little bit, right? It's a little eerie. This next one's a little Easter eggy as well. The sanitation worker, the garbage man at the end, is actually supposed to be Sid when he's all grown up, and it's actually credited. It's credited as Sid.
Is it credited? Yeah.
So like that is clearly their intention. So you see his skull T-shirt on him.
That makes sense.
So Sid was like the bad guy in the first one, and this fact or whoever wrote this was like he's more of a hero towards the end because he puts Lotso on the garbage truck or whatever, and the gang goes on the back of the truck. I was like, I don't know if he's like a hero, but
he doesn't know he's a hero. He's just doing his job.
He's just rocking out.
Yeah.
And he's also voiced by, I don't know, this to me was kind of funny. It's Eric Von Detten, who is like a Princess Diaries.
Yeah, I know Eric Von Detten.
And I'm like, this is so random and weird.
That is really random.
Speaking of voice actors, I just had to shout out this one too, that Barbie is voiced by Jodie Benson, who is Ariel. So,
oh, that's
like,
fun.
Yeah, that's fun.
Who does got a great Lotso? Voice.
Lost some old guy. I don't remember some his name. Some old white guy.
Ned Betty.
I feel like Yeti. He is a somebody, but whoops. So speaking of Lotso, actually, my last kind of like particular here is that when Lotso, the noteworthy villain of Toy Story, he actually caused Disney a lot of grief in real life because they got sued by a company called Lisa, I don't know, Industries. But anyways, they owned a trademark for lots of hugs. So for him to be the Lotso Hugs Bear, the bears don't even really look that similar, but it was the name specifically for the Lotso Huggin' Bear that they were like getting sued. I think, I don't even remember who came out on top of this. I think Dice Lisa maybe did. It was just too similar. And then to like sidestep into animation angle a little.
Oh, before you go into animation angle, I think there is one very big particular in voice acting that I think is extremely important to shout out.
Is it
Well, you should say
Andy.
It's Andy.
Yeah. Andy's the same voice actor that he was
amazing.
In the first one.
Yeah. John Morris. He's They're like, oh, he's matured now. Get that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Yeah. I think that is seamless. A very nice touch that they did that. Yeah. So yeah, this animation angle is basically just one note, but as we've been kind of talking about on this podcast, like they keep learning. They've clearly like figured everything out at this point for animation and looks and stuff, like fur and lighting and all that. Like this movie looks like crazy different than the first Toy Stories.
Buster
and, like,
makes a brief appearance.
Buster has all his fur. Like he's like a full dog now.
He's an older guy.
Yeah, he's an old boy.
Like realistically, animating fur wasn't even really a huge concern anymore at this point. But the biggest challenge in this one was actually, and I remember thinking this watching it, being like, oh, this is kind of impressive for a weird little thing. But the trash bags, when they're all in the trash bags, the way the light comes through the bag and like Rex's tail poking it.
The poking? That is interesting. That would be tough.
They have like special properties of how like light reflects and goes through the bags that to make that realistic is actually pretty hard.
Yeah.
And so they spent a long time trying to figure out how to get the trash bags right. And I mean, even the incinerator moment near the end, like the amount of trash, like that was like a whole thing too.
And the monkeys and the bridge in the beginning where the bridge explodes.
Yeah. Like, that's like a Wreck-It Ralph, like tons of fucking monkeys there. Yeah.
That is a lot.
That's what the cans say now. They don't say barrel of monkeys. They say tons of fucking monkeys.
Yeah. I do remember that blowing my mind when I saw it in theaters, just that initial bridge explosion, then all those monkeys and just being like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Did you have anything else for animation angles?
No, that is it.
Okay, I have a couple additions to animation angle. One is you might have noticed there's a bit of clothing in this movie, specifically with Ken's fancy closet. So this movie had like more clothing than any of their other movies, and I found it interesting that before this movie they had like digital tailors who were like actual tailors, but learn to do it digitally. So they would like cut out the shapes and basically like stitch the clothing together in the computer and then like put on the characters. And it sounds super time consuming. And it's like insane that they used to do it that way. And they were like, we can't do that on this film. So they developed, of course, like they always do, they developed a new way to do clothing that allowed any modeler to basically do what the tailors were doing, but faster, and also auto simulate the cloth. So it really sped it up, and they went from Toy Story 1, which had 76 bits of clothing, to over 300 in this movie, which is pretty crazy. And I feel like 290 of those are in Ken's closet. So, very impressive.
More on that later.
What collection was it that she was ripping and that's what broke him? Like the Nehru collection or something?
Yeah, like whatever. It was like just a piece of formal wear.
I think it's just so funny.
Ken's so a beautiful
good.
Garment.
Ken's so good. Mm-hmm. I only wish that, I hope.
Save it.
Okay, fine.
yeah.
You know what I was gonna
say. Save it.
So one of the other little tidbits I have for animation angle that I found, and I feel like Sam would find this interesting as well, being in the industry, is that during the initial development of Toy Story, they were like, oh, cool, we'll just go grab our old builds from Toy Story 1 and 2 and reuse those. We'll save a bunch of time and effort. Aha, but when they tried to open those builds, they couldn't open them, and they just kept getting error messages. So they ended up having to redo all the builds for this movie, which for me, like with my job, my first reaction is like, I wonder if they budgeted that in, because they probably went into the movie like budget and like pipeline wise being like, whatever, we've got the builds from last one, we'll just update them and move on with our lives. But no, they would have had to like completely pivot and like redo all those builds, which is pretty crazy. It's
a lot of work. I feel like I would have assumed that they'd be redoing them anyway, because it's like 10 years later or something, and the tech and everything had been come so far. Like, I don't know, in my head I'm like, I would have assumed, like, I guess you have a jumping off point. I don't know exactly how Maya works, but
you wouldn't reuse from it's more that you don't have to start from scratch. Like they've got the overall build and the skeleton, and then they can add and build on from there, whereas they have to do like every pixel from the beginning again. Same as for our stuff, you know, we go to a new version of Harmony and we'll take those builds and then we'll update them with new things and tweak them and bring them up. So yeah, but you don't have to redraw every single hand again.
Right.
That's it, I think, for animation angle. I mean, obviously the animation was beautiful. It's kind of hard to really deep dive into Pixar movies when every movie is mm-hmm. an event movie and looks amazing. So pretty crazy. But
really smell the strawberries on Lotso through that animation. I don't know. You owned a Lotso thing, right?
I bought a Lotso for our nephews, Nathan and Kit. And then I learned that they're a scent-free household.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I saw Lotso, he was abandoned in a corner of the laundry room.
Yeah, scent-free house. Yeah, that's right. But he did smell of strawberries.
He smelled so good.
He smelled great.
And he was so huggable.
Yeah, he's like,
man.
I want one.
I was wondering how long that smell lasts, because like Lotso was lost a while ago, and then he's in the garbage dump, and the garbage man just picks up like garbage and smells it. Like, I don't know.
That shit never leaves, man. Yeah.
No, that's why he was in the corner of the laundry room.
Okay, so we are going to quickly get into a 1-star, 5-star, which interestingly enough, normally I go to Google reviews to find some 1-star, 5-star.
You did not go to Google reviews? What?
You didn't let me finish, Tong. I went to Google reviews, but I don't know if this has happened before. There were no 1-star or 2-star reviews on Google for Toy Story 3.
What? Not even troll
not even
reviews?
Trolls.
The more current we get, the less fun 5-star, 1-stars.
So there was like a blip in the bar, like when you see the review bars, but when I went to filter, it just came up like basically error. There was no reviews. And I was like, but how is there like a blip on the bar? Anyway, so we got a couple 3-star reviews that I'm just gonna bump down to 1-star because I tried to find the funny ones.
3-star, 5-star? What the fuck?
So the first quote unquote 1-star review is from John Bon the Great.
I thought you were gonna say John Bon Jovi.
If only. At parts, it can be a little bit creepy, and in my opinion, I don't care for the Bonnie type storyline. I don't like how it moves away from Andy. I mean, I get how they need a new person to play with the toys since it is the third movie and Andy as a person, but I didn't really care for it. But all this hate could be because I had a family member named Andy. So basically, he didn't really like the movie, but that might be because he just got a family member.
Yeah. In summary, Andy. I hate my brother, so I hate this movie.
Yeah. Then we got Blake Masereri, I think. This is a short one. I used to love this movie, but when I watched it again, I did not like it as much as I used to. It's still a good movie, though.
These 3-star reviews are way less exciting.
Oh, my God.
Right?
They're so like, honestly, they're these all were like 3 stars.
These were the most interesting ones I could find.
No, that's good.
I was tempted to go to a different
You know
space,
what? Maybe we have to if like there's maybe
we'll wait and see.
There's no way this is going to happen again.
Yeah, it's true. This is an event movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
I should have wrote my own 1-star review just to get it in there. All right, 5 stars. So, all right, this one I'll try to my best to summarize. It's a longer one. This is from Don't Read This Comment, but so I had to read it, of course. Toy Story 3 is everything. This is the first time I ever cried watching a movie.
Hmm.
Other movies have definitely come close, like Coco, Wall-E, and many more. The ending is easily the best part of the movie. It was so powerful. Seeing Andy learn to let go of his childhood so he can improve in others is unlike anything else I've seen. The comedy is the comedy in this is really good and varied. The score is also really good. Even if it's what you've come to expect from Toy Story, this movie is so good. I definitely recommend this to somebody. Now, that's a pretty good 5-star.
Nice.
From.
That's nice.
I mean, we should be reading this comment, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It's misleading. Then the last one I have is another 5-star from Nyla Melody, another short one. This is my favorite movie ever, and I'm not just saying that because I haven't watched a lot of movies.
Nice, Nyla.
So, pretty good quote-unquote 1-star, 5-star reviews.
Mm-hmm.
And now, everybody's favorite is hot takes.
Hot takes. I think we all know what it's brought to you by.
The end incinerator. Yeah.
That is a good.
Yeah, fair. It had to happen.
So yeah, I'll start us off with, I got a few little hot takes here. So Lotso, he's running a cult, right?
Fair.
Like,
yeah.
This is a cult.
It's like, more like the pyramid scheme, like they kind of like.
Or like a dictatorship.
Yeah. But they say
they're all the same.
There's overlapping things.
They have to earn their way up.
Maybe the center of that Venn diagram is throwing toys to die.
It's like a death cult kind of thing. Sunnyside. I don't know. Yep. It just all felt very culty to me.
Mm-hmm.
Laura, I see you scrolling quite a bit on your device there. You've probably got a lot of hot takes. Your first one?
I got a few. And the first is, I would tolerate the caterpillar room if it meant a night in Ken's closet. I mean,
but Ken's not in the caterpillar room.
No, but like, I'm just saying, I would tolerate the caterpillar room if it meant that at night I got to go to Ken's club.
Oh, I see. I gotcha. Okay. That's pretty good. Yeah. That's really good.
Tongue, what about you?
Why didn't Andy just give his toys to Molly?
He
doesn't like Molly.
Andy's being a brother about it.
He's just like, get out of my room, Molly. Like, you don't need my toys, Molly. But like, Molly, like, kind of seemed like she mentioned, like, oh, I can't wait till you leave so I can have all your stuff. I feel like they might have got another maybe 2 years out of Molly.
But she threw out her Barbie.
She did.
Yeah, but
can't be trusted.
Barbie's old news. Everyone else is kind of cool. So.
But I think it goes like these toys and then Barbie in terms of age. Like, I feel like they're for younger kids than Barbies are.
What? Do you think so? Yeah. You think a Buzz Lightyear action figure is lesser than a Barbie?
Yes.
Yes.
In terms
Fuck
of age.
Fuck you both.
Yeah.
Barbie and Ken have way more small accessories. They're for ages 8 and up.
Oh, yeah. Barbie will last you forever. Mm-hmm. Well, not forever, but definitely till you're older.
These are hot takes.
Spicy.
Maybe for
Buzz Lightyear can become Mrs. Nesbitt, which is a callback from Toy Story 1.
Name one removable accessory on Buzz Lightyear. No choking hazards. He's meant for younger kids.
His arms.
It's true.
Come
that
off.
Kid tries to shove Buzz.
Yeah, but they're not chokeable.
In the mouth, can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you could probably poke an eye out with that. His fingers, though.
That's why Ken's in the older kids' room.
His like thing that like comes out from his like not his laser, but like the thing that he like looks at the phone flap. Number, yeah. The little flap. I bet you that comes off.
Yeah, but it's not supposed to.
Yeah, but someone could choke. Anyways. He should have given his toys to Molly for a bit.
That's
and then that way Andy could have like seen his toys for a few more years. I mean, anytime he came home from college. But as we know, it seemed like he was getting kicked out of the house for good.
Yeah.
His room was entirely empty.
Yeah. I think she was
never
too
coming
old for
back.
Those toys.
Never coming back.
Maybe yeah. It was going to turn into a studio.
She was treating Andy like he was
painting.
Dying.
Yeah. Sam, well, you got any?
Yeah. Oh, I've got a few of this.
Ooh,
oh,
wow.
Juicy. Look at us all coming.
For an event movie, Sam's coming packing.
I know. Michael Keaton's Ken walked so Ryan Gosling could fly.
Was it Michael Keaton?
Yeah.
What?
Get
really?
Out of here.
Yeah. I don't know that either.
It's that Michael is Keaton. A really, I mean, it was the correct choice.
Wow,
but
I didn't know that
a
either.
A non-intuitive casting choice, I would say.
Like,
he did slay
dong.
It.
Slam dunk.
Killed it.
Wow, yeah. I did not know that. Well, hey, listen, when this episode comes out, the Barbie movie would have come out too.
Yeah. Yeah.
But as of this recording, the Barbie movie has not come out. So we don't know for sure, even though the trailers seem to be pointing, this Barbie movie is going to be really fucking good. And Margot Robbie and Ken or Ryan Gosling would be great. But we don't know. Ryan Gosling could not be good.
As much as I say that, I think it would be pretty hard to top Michael Keaton Ken, to be honest. So, I don't know.
Well, this is earlier I was telling Tongue to save it. And I'm sure this is one of his hot takes. But my hot take is I hope the Barbie movie has the exact same energy as Barbie and Ken in this movie.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
The elevator.
Incredible.
I love you. That's how we said love.
So good.
All right. My next one, Mr. Picklehead, definitely better
cucumber.
Than Pickle Rick. Is it a cucumber?
Yeah.
Okay.
He can still be better than Pickle Rick.
I think it still can.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Clearly, it's a ripoff of Mr. Cucumberhead.
Yeah.
Who is Pickle Rick?
It's a Rick and Morty
from
thing.
Rick okay. and Morty. Yeah.
Yeah.
They even look the same. I was like, oh my God, it's like the exact same thing.
Except that Mr. Potato Head is so good at like balancing his like bowler hat on a cucumber, on a tortilla.
That's a challenge.
It's amazing. Yeah.
It's very impressive. Even with like jumping around and stuff. Spectacular.
Yeah.
Laura, did you have another one?
Yeah. I think it was maybe Toy Story 2 that I introduced my toys as parents theory, where I was like, if you watch the movie with the perspective that the toys are actually Andy's parents, it like gives it a new meaning. And I think that holds up here. They're like afraid of being abandoned, afraid of being forgotten, afraid that he's not going to come home to them, that he's not going to pay them any attention. He's never going to want to play with them again. Gotcha. And I think that's every parent's fear in sending their kids to college. Like at that point, it's really the ball's in the kids' court. Are they going to stay in touch? Are they going to come home and visit? Are they going to want to hang out just because they choose to? It'll break your heart. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you just need to be given away to a new kid.
That's it. You just got to adopt a kid.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Tongue. I assume you have some more.
I have some more. I have a few like kind of like lowball ones. And then I'll throw my other ones. Really quickly, Toy Story 1 to 3 is one of the greatest trilogies of all time. I'm going to go ahead and say that, 1 to 3. And then the other one is, if you don't cry from this movie or not like shed a single tear, you're a fucking monster. I don't care who you are.
Brad, did you cry?
No.
Not even a tear?
No. I did get misty, though. But I didn't cry.
Tell him he's a fucking monster, Tom.
You're a fucking monster, yeah. Brad. Well, no, if you get misty, like...
I got misty, yeah.
Sam, does Brad cry at anything?
It's very, very... I've maybe seen it once.
Fox and the Hound? Brad.
No, oh, I've never seen him cry at a movie, no.
Okay, so misty is the best we can get out of Brad, is what you're saying? So that's great.
Probably.
So that's great.
I can well up, you know, I can feel it in like the back of my throat a little bit, but that's as far as it usually goes.
Wow. Well,
sorry. I'm mostly dead inside.
You're dead inside. I'm sorry. But I'll take Misty. I think that's pretty good.
Did you have any others you wanted to hand out?
I'll let Sam go because she has a few this time. Okay. So
yeah,
I do. My next one is... So at the beginning of the movie there, they have to amp themselves up to make that phone call. And I think having to amp yourself up to make a phone call is the most relatable moment in the movie.
Oh my God, story of my life. Every time I get a voicemail at work.
That's funny.
Oh boy.
I feel like that's every time somebody rings our doorbell. I'm just like, what the fuck? Are we getting attacked? Like, what is happening? My next one is less of a hot take, maybe more of a hot question, hot discussion. So... between Babyface from this movie, Big Baby and Babyface from the first movie, the mechanical legged baby, who would win in a fight?
I mean, Big Baby has the advantage of having...
Well, Big Baby's like big and got the strength, but arms. Slow. Whereas Babyface is quick.
I think Babyface would win. Babyface.
I think Babyface would take Big Baby.
There's more like... spider shit that can happen.
I think Babyface would win as well.
For sure.
I think they would team up and take down Lotso and Sid.
Although so here's the situation I just like visualized in my head. If like say the attack is like Babyface climbs up Big Baby and Big Baby's like, trying to get Babyface off of Big Baby. If there's a situation where Big Baby can get a hold of this is getting confusing.
Yeah,
it's game over.
Yeah.
But if Big Baby can grab Babyface, game over. Just slam dunk it into the ground. It's done.
I think Big Baby could Hulk smash. No, Big Baby could Hulk smash Babyface.
100%. That's what I mean. Like, if there's a moment where
one good hit, done.
Yeah. He just needs to like, get one punch in and it's over. Whereas Babyface got to duck and weave the whole time.
It's a speed versus strength kind of classic.
Yeah. He's just got to like tire. Babyface has to tire Big Baby out over time and then take him out. Much like Homer, Homer boxing.
Mm-hmm.
Laura, what else you got?
Did I ever tell you guys about Shelly?
No.
I don't think so.
Shelly was my doll. Shelly was a Cabbage Patch doll. She had blue eyes, a single curly red lock, beautiful bonnet, and a nice squeaker. And when I was a young girl of 5, 6 years old, I had her in the car with me as my family drove to Montreal, and my brothers decided to play catch with Shelly while the doors were open, and Shelly was thrown out the window of the car on
oh my god
on a highway.
Oh my god.
Was this never to be seen again?
Where's the hot take?
Was Shelley replaced?
Or so I thought, until we were returning from Montreal and my eagle-eyed mother spotted Shelley on the side of the road. And
no
my
way.
Parents pulled over and told me that there was a deer. And so I was terrified of all creatures and so refused to look outside. And then they got in the car and came back to the car holding Shelley.
Wow. Shelley.
And never let your brothers touch it again.
And never let my brothers touch it again. I then brought Shelley on vacation.
There's more to this story.
Yeah. I just keep going.
To Florida when I was 13 years old. And when we were packing up to come home from Florida, we couldn't find Shelley.
Oh my God.
And so Shelley now lives in Florida. Don't know what happened to her, but I'm sure she's living a good life.
Wow.
And eventually my mom did buy me a new Shelley that she found on eBay. But the Shelley had a rattle instead of a squeaker.
Interesting.
So that's my own Toy Story.
Wow.
And I thought that I would share it with everyone today.
Wow.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Shelley.
Not really a hot take, but a riveting story.
It felt like more appropriate in this category than during the summary.
Not the Who Fuck segment. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Tong, back to you,
Andy. Okay. I only have two more here. I'll just give both of mine now. One of them, multiverse movies are oversaturated, but Into the Barbieverse would be pretty fucking cool. And the other one is, why didn't Andy ever have Ham out, like, as a bank, like, on his desk or something like that? It's clearly a piggy bank, but he only ever threw it in with his toys. I know he played it with a toy, like, but he had money in there. So why didn't he just, like, put it on his desk? Why wasn't it always just out? You know,
gotta hide it from the sibling.
I think it's sweet. I think it shows that, like, to him, the value of Ham as a toy was greater than the value of him as a bank. I think it's
a
demonstration of Andy's values.
Couldn't you do both with Ham? Like, just have him on your desk and also, you know.
No, because this way he gets to be with the other toys.
I guess.
It's true.
But he never. Okay. You're right.
Family.
It's all the Fast and Furious.
Family. All about family. Did you have a last one?
No, that's it. Those two.
Oh, okay. Oh, that was two. Okay. I'll do my last two as well then. My first one is more of a hot question as well. Just thinking about how he put Woody in the college box. And I was just wondering if any of you actually took any childhood toys to college.
No, I lived at home in university.
I mean, I'm pretty sentimental and, like, I brought a stuffed animal from a boyfriend in high school, but, like, I didn't have any, like, childhood toys on me. I feel like they were all in chests in the basement. Like,
I would agree. I don't think I had anything from that old. Like, I'm pretty sure I took, like, toys with me, but nothing that was like, from when I was like five or something.
No Woodies.
Yeah.
I brought a Mickey Mouse. And my floor mates did unspeakable things.
Oh my God, there's the next movie.
It was a mistake.
I think the closest thing that I would ever have brought would be, like, I have this childhood blanket that now is like Captain Meatball's blanket, but, like, it's been with me ever since, for as long as I can remember. And I refuse to give it up. So, like, that's the closest thing as, like, a childhood thing or toy that I would bring. Not really a toy, though.
Yeah, I had like a pillow from when I was like a baby that I took with me, but not really a toy. I don't know where that is anymore, but it's somewhere. I for sure still have it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My last one is quite hot. So hot that maybe we have to discuss it at a later film as well or later. But I think this movie's really awesome. I think everything else they do after this with Toy Story cheapens it a lot. And I think it like hurts. I love it and I agree as a trilogy. These three are amazing, but capitalism ruins everything. And like the fact that there's so many shorts and TV shows and another movie coming out, I'm like, man, you killed it. Like, what? You had this perfect thing. And it, I feel like it cheapens it a little.
Yeah.
That's very similar to my final hot take, which is that Toy Story 3 didn't need to happen, but I'm glad it did.
Toy Story 3 didn't need to happen? Yeah.
It didn't need to happen. They could have ended at 2. But
yeah,
I'm glad it happened.
Wow.
All of our final hot takes are all dovetailing together here. because I saved my hottest take for last, which I think Toy Story 3, as much as it's a great movie and a great ending to a trilogy, is the worst of the two movies on its own.
Two of the three movies.
Of the three movies, sorry.
Not including four.
Like,
yeah, well, yeah, we haven't watched yet.
We'll talk about
it. I'm ignoring four, but of the three movies. So consider this, all right? I'm not saying it's a bad movie. I'm definitely not. I talked about
you could talk,
I
like Brad, it. But Sam.
I feel like you're going to jump get the through bat. The screen at me.
Sam, get the bat.
Sam, we're going to need you to appear in Brad's background in the next 10 seconds.
This movie can't stand on its own. Everything about this movie needs you to have watched the other two movies.
That's a stupid argument. And
everything
I'm going to go ahead
and goes back to that. All the gags are repeats of the other two movies. Like, if you go into this movie without having seen the other two, all of the emotional plot points don't land nearly as well. Like, if I was to rewatch any movies, it would not be this one. It's a great ending to a trilogy, but same as the Return of the King is not the best of the Lord of the Rings. It's the same thing here. They're all great movies.
Why is that a problem?
Return of the King was my favorite. And I
no,
feel
and that's
like
weird.
I like Return of the King too. I like Return of the King as well.
I'm not saying I didn't like any of these movies.
I know, I know.
Saying,
I just think that there's a you can like. I mean, now I'm getting heated.
No, I told you.
No, I love this, Brad. And
I'm
I,
just saying, if you want to go for a long walk through the woods, then go outside.
I don't disagree with you in a vacuum, but these things aren't in a vacuum. Like,
oh, yeah,
you're not
yeah.
going to just watch. It's like watching Avengers Endgame without any of the context, right? Like, there's like payoff that happens for like watching a franchise through.
Exactly.
And like, I think that is fine to expect their audience to do some of that before watching the end of a thing, the end of a saga, right? So like, yeah, if someone's never seen Toy Story before and just watched Toy Story 3, I think they're going to have a good time, but they won't have that like same emotional attachment, which I think is what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But like, I think those people need to, you should do the homework and do those other things. Like any like video game sequel or anything like that, like you should play the other ones first. You should watch those other ones to get full enjoyment. And not every movie has to like start from square one where you don't have. That's why the MCU movies for so long worked. Was that because you watched those other ones that you felt satisfied for watching the later ones? That's how
I also
I feel.
Think you could get a lot out of this one without watching. I think I would agree. Like, yes, you get a lot more having the background of the others, but I do think the emotional beats that hit, like specifically for me, like the incinerator, like I think like that is like kind of a universal feeling that we hadn't really dived into. And I think that is all on its own in this movie. Like the idea of like, of them being together, like they make that clear from the beginning, like that it's like about the bondage of this like family and like stuff. So I don't know, I feel like if I had watched this on its own, like sure, the Andy stuff maybe doesn't hit as hard, but the idea of him like throwing out his toys, I feel like could still,
I think that's still
work.
Relatable to like,
and it's like a prison break with a lot of fun. So I don't know, to me that's just like its own thing.
But even with like most people, except my brother-in-law, because he doesn't like Toy Story, he never grew up with toys, but I think a lot of people who grew up with toys probably can relate to the Andy character without seeing one and two to some extent, where they have to say goodbye to their childhood in a way. So I think there's still that, like, yeah.
Question, did you guys donate attic or garbage?
Donate.
I addict.
Attic.
Yeah. But donated against my will. My mom just kind of gave it all away while I was gone.
I think donated to like family, but like a lot of them just hoarded into like the basement.
We'll call that attic.
Attic.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a good take, Brad. I
don't disagree with anything you guys are saying.
It's hot.
I think
I like
as
a hot
a
take.
Movie, it should stand alone. Terminator 2, amazing movie on its own. There's a lot of good movies that stand on their own. And if it's to be a truly great movie, it needs to be considered in a vacuum without standing on the shoulders of those that came before it. Avengers is an amazing movie, but it's even better if you've seen the other ones. Just saying. That's why it's a hot
take.
That's
the same as this one. Yeah. I think this does stand alone.
We'll probably circle back to this when we do.
We will circle back
ring.
To this, and Sam will have the bat ready.
Doug's going to make sure we do that one in person. Okay. Well, I feel like that was a pretty spicy way to end the episode. Mm-hmm. So I feel like we're going to, you know, shift things back a few gears when we get into the next podcast, the next movie, when we get back on the road, see some more stuff, and we get into Cars 2.
I can't believe we're going from one of the greatest movies.
I mean, I could see the delight on all of your faces.
So who has seen Cars 2?
Not
I'm
me.
Pretty sure I have.
I have not.
I do not remember it. Not.
My understanding of the plot is that it's Lightning McQueen and Larry the Cable Guy, whatever his name is, become international spies.
Okay.
Yes.
Which like is the movie. Dumbest concept for a film I've ever heard. But
hot take already.
Listen, I'm knee deep in F1, everybody. And I feel like when we watched Cars was like the first week that I started watching Drive to Survive. So I am secretly a little bit excited for
I think
our
you
next
get
one.
Disappointed because they're not going
to be like, disappointed.
Yeah, they're not going to explain
doesn't
things
matter.
The way they-
I'm going to be forcing F1 comparisons into our next episode.
I despise it.
Get excited.
Ka-chow.
Oh, you're being a real
sad ka-chow.
You're being a real Lance right now, Tom.
All right. Oh, well, with all this enthusiasm, Laura and Sam, would you two like to sing us out?
Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.